In 1981, these are the fastest trains in the world. But French engineers want to see just how fast they can go. Reaching 380 kilometers an hour, the TGV smashes past a world record that's held for over 25 years. The French have something to prove, because 40 years ago, amid controversy and doubt, this train took on the plane and won. Only a few decades earlier, it seemed that trains had reached their limit. In experimental runs, railway engineers had pushed them to incredible speeds. But in actual service, trains around the world weren't anywhere near as fast, nor were they getting any faster. In the 1950s, they ran at about the same speeds as they did in the 1930s. The problem was, engineering a faster locomotive would only get you so far. With many rail lines having been built a half century earlier, they had sharp curves, steep grades to climb, and outdated signaling that just couldn't handle higher speeds. Getting trains to go faster would mean having to rebuild the tracks they ran on, which was not only expensive, many were convinced it was pointless. Because the 1960s was the dawn of the jet age. Air travel offered unparalleled speed, while the automobile promised unmatched freedom and convenience. The train was no match for either. Around the world, billions were spent building new superhighways, short-haul air routes were growing in popularity, and just around the corner, new technologies and radical transport solutions promised to reshape travel entirely. Many saw trains as an antiquated 19th century technology. But halfway around the world, the Japanese were about to change everything. When everyone else had given up on railways, the Japanese had just completed one of the most ambitious rail projects of the century. Building more than 500 kilometers of near perfectly straight track, tunneling through mountains, and constructing over 1,000 bridges. The Japanese called it the Shinkansen. And when it opened in 1964, the trains on this new railway ran at over 200 kilometers per hour, faster than anywhere in the world. The Shinkansen was a new kind of railway, one reserved exclusively for high-speed trains. Taking the most direct route possible, it cut the travel time between Japan's two largest cities in half. But it wasn't just its speed that was impressive, it was the scale. The Shinkansen could move a huge volume of people. A single train carried nearly 1,000 passengers, and over 120 trains ran every single day, one every 15 minutes. In just the first 3 years, the Shinkansen moved more than 100 million passengers. And two cities located nearly 500 kilometers apart were seemingly pulled closer together. But as the world looked on in admiration, railway engineers in France were dismayed. The French were no strangers to getting their trains to go fast. Only a few years earlier, French engineers had set a remarkable train speed record, putting themselves at the forefront of railway technology. In areas of acceleration, braking, and electric pickup at high speeds, they were world leaders. But none of that seemed to matter, because the top brass running France's railways, the SNCF, lacked vision. Facing record deficits, they were obsessed with short-term fixes, cutting costs, reducing service, and closing down rail lines. But the opening of the Shinkansen sparked a profound shift in thinking. Up until then, the fastest trains in France had almost always been luxurious trains, scheduled to run maybe once or twice a day, with all first-class seating and expensive fares. But the Japanese had shown how speed and frequency were commodities that could be sold to an eager public. And that got them thinking. In the preceding years, French domestic air travel had exploded in popularity, a trend that was only expected to continue. But the irony was that an ever-increasing share of the time flying to a destination was actually spent on the ground, stuck on congested roads or in crowded airports. Turns out, going faster didn't always mean saving time, and the SNCF could use that to their advantage. At distances of up to 1,000 kilometers, a high-speed train scheduled to run frequently could go head-to-head with the airplane. And if it was made affordable, it could win back passengers. Within months, SNCF went on the offensive with a bold plan for high-speed point-to-point connections between major cities. But where the Japanese had spent enormous sums building an entirely new rail network, right down to all new stations, that wasn't going to work for the French. SNCF would have to keep costs down, utilizing as much of their existing network as possible. Instead, they'd focus their efforts on developing a new kind of train, experimenting with locomotives powered by gas turbines taken straight from military helicopters. Using aircraft technology had a few key advantages. Gas turbines were light and powerful, and they would allow trains to run on steeper grades, so tracks could be built with fewer tunnels and bridges. And kerosene-fueled gas turbines would eliminate the need to build expensive overhead lines. And the French were prepared to take it a step further than the Japanese, aiming for dramatically higher speeds. In 1972, SNCF unveiled the TGV-001, an experimental train with cutting-edge technologies and a top speed of more than 300 kilometers per hour. This was a train designed to sell high-speed rail to a skeptical public. World-renowned designer Jacques Cooper was hired to design a train that didn't look like a train. Taking inspiration from his earlier work on sports cars, Cooper gave the TGV bold, sleek lines that were undeniably cool. Gone were the opulent rail cars of earlier French express trains, replaced with modern aircraft-like cabins. Gas turbines produced an impressive 5,000 horsepower and powered electric motors that drove each of the train's wheels. Articulated bogies reduced weight, improved stability, and offered a smooth, quieter ride. In testing, the prototype racked up over 500,000 kilometers and accelerated beyond 300 kilometers per hour more than 175 times. Just about anyone with political sway was invited to ride the train of the future and hear SNCF's vision for high-speed rail. With proven technology, the French were on the verge of putting the world's fastest train into service. But many leaders wanted nothing to do with the TGV. There were fears that it would be a Concorde on rails, another massively expensive vanity project without hope of ever turning a profit. Others dismissed it as benefiting the wealthy, with new lines skipping past smaller cities to serve the Paris elite. And there were still competing visions for the future of French transport. The Aerotrain, a radical tracked hovercraft that ran on an elevated concrete guideway, was also making headlines. With a promised speed of over 400 kilometers an hour, it stole some of the TGV's thunder and gained considerable support. Meanwhile, the Civil Aviation Administration pushed for the development of airliners capable of short takeoff and landings, and even the construction of compact runways right in the center of Paris. Support for the TGV wasn't anywhere near what the SNCF hoped for, and things would only get worse. In 1973, the price of oil began to skyrocket, rising nearly 300% in a single year. Oil-exporting nations in the Middle East had imposed an embargo on the West, sending shockwaves throughout the global economy and causing widespread fuel shortages. France was among the worst hit, where almost three-quarters of the country's energy needs depended on imported oil. After years of development, SNCF found itself having gone all in on fuel-thirsty gas turbines, right as the era of cheap oil was ending. But for the TGV, the energy crisis would turn out to be a blessing in disguise. In 1974, the French Prime Minister launched an ambitious plan to meet the country's energy needs with nuclear power, pledging to build over 150 nuclear plants under the slogan, "In France, we do not have oil, but we have ideas." For SNCF, the decision was a game changer. They began working on an electric version of the TGV. Switching from gas turbine to electric traction was a huge undertaking, calling for the development of new pantographs, suspension, and braking systems. But French railway engineers, who had a history of pushing electric locomotives to their limits, managed to complete the modifications in just 2 years. And the switch from gas to electric would soon pay off in a big way. cars, airliners, and aerotrains depended on imported oil, while the TGV could run on French nuclear energy. The optics were powerful, but the energy crisis also forced leaders to prioritize public transport. And by March 1976, the necessary approvals were in place for the construction of a new line connecting France's two largest cities. And it would largely be paid for with private capital, not government subsidies. Soon, large swaths of countryside bore witness to a massive construction project, the first major Western European rail line in nearly half a century. With a sleek new look for the 1980s, the TGV was set to debut as the fastest train in the world. But just months before opening in 1981, French railway engineers would do what they did best, find out just how fast they could go. In a highly publicized event, they pushed the TGV well beyond its initial operating speed, all the way up to 380 kilometers per hour, smashing the world record they had set decades earlier. But while the 1955 record had pushed railway technology to its literal breaking point, 380 kilometers per hour was achieved with the very same train that would soon go into service, paving the way for even higher speeds in the future. From its opening in September 1981, the success of the TGV surprised even the SNCF. Only 2 months after opening, it had already carried its millionth passenger. And within a year, France's largest domestic airline saw a 60% decline in passengers between Paris and Lyon. Many of the public's criticisms faded, as the price of a ticket wasn't any higher than on a regular train. And an aggressive marketing campaign promoted the TGV's efficiency, time savings, and accessibility. And as if on cue, politicians who had vehemently opposed the TGV in the 1960s and 70s now proudly proclaimed their support for it all along. Almost immediately, SNCF began to plan for new lines connecting more French cities. Over the years, service speeds also increased, and in experimental runs, French railway engineers continued to push the limit, ultimately reaching 574 kilometers an hour in 2007, a railway speed record that holds to this day. Like the Shinkansen, the TGV was an immediate technical and commercial success, and by the mid-1980s, it had become a symbol of national pride, a nearly two-decade-old vision that had finally been confirmed. The train had taken on the plane and won. And as a testament to the forward thinking of railway engineers, today, high-speed rail is more relevant than ever. The 1991 Gulf War was a defining moment in modern warfare, a showcase of advanced military technology on a massive scale. And in the opening hours of the conflict, Iraq commanded the fourth largest military in the world, with an air force of nearly 700 combat-ready aircraft. Among these was the Soviet-built MiG-25 Foxbat, a Cold War-era interceptor that by many accounts was too heavy, too unmaneuverable, and too outdated to put up much of a fight. But the Iraqis would push the aircraft to its limit, leveraging any advantage they could find in a daring plan to ambush state-of-the-art American F-15s as they patrolled the skies over Baghdad. The outcome wasn't what anyone would have expected. You can learn more about the incredible Samurai air battle in my latest video, now on Nebula. Nebula is home to a growing number of exclusive Mustard videos. Whether it's the stories behind iconic machines or bringing unrealized concepts to life. And it's where you can expect to see a lot more exciting projects in the near future, including reimagining what the world would have looked like if mass supersonic air travel had become reality. But you might be asking, why are these videos only on Nebula? On YouTube, algorithms influence which videos you see, and advertisers restrict the type of content that creators can make. Nebula is not like YouTube, and that fundamentally changes how I make videos. On Nebula, I can make a video as long as it needs to be. The videos only have to make Mustard viewers happy, not a general audience, which is what the YouTube algorithm demands. and that means I can cover fascinating technical details in more depth, bring lesser-known concepts to life, or experiment with entirely new formats. There's no algorithm, there's only you. But there's one other very important difference. Nebula is owned directly by us, the creators. There's no one else to answer to, and we're not lining someone else's pockets. And that means your support goes directly into funding more high-quality projects that otherwise would have never been made. When you sign up for Nebula, you also get access to Nebula classes, where you can even take entire courses on how to become a creator yourself. Sign up using the link below and you'll get a $20 discount, meaning for just $2.50 a month, you'll support Mustard. And in return, you'll get access to tons of new premium content from your favorite creators.